address and take the session forward.
Mr. Pradeep Kumar, the Commissioner of Bolpur Chapter, my co-speaker, Vivek Rana, Mr. Chakravarti, the Assistant Commissioner, Landic Friends, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Today we have organized these workshops as a part of our outreach program of the chamber, and I welcome all of you in these workshops. Please make sure that it is participatory, because we have already passed around 2 years with regard to the compliances under GST process. So I would expect most of you are reasonably knowledgeable in this area, but still we discuss certain core issues in these workshops. So please interact with the speakers, understand the issues, core issues, and I hope these workshops will be of great help to all of you. We have all come from Calcutta with a lot of expectations from you that there will be an interactions, we can learn something from you. We'll also share our views and our expert opinions on these subjects. Let it be a participatory, and I'm sure that we'll organize similar programs on other commercial issues like foreign trade policy, income tax, direct tax codes are coming. So we have got a wonderful response from all of you. So we are thinking to hold few more workshops here, and we have got tremendous amount of cooperations from the department, from the sponsors, from the speakers, and also from the chamber. You must be knowing that Bengal Chamber of Commerce is the oldest chamber of commerce in the country, not in Bengal or Calcutta or West Bengal. It is the first chamber of commerce in the country, about 200 years back. And we organize around 100 workshops and training programs during the year on various subjects. Tax is just a part of that. So you can reap the benefits of these workshops, and I am sure it will be of great help. We are grateful to Mr. Pradeep Kumar. He has come all the way from Bolpur and to grace these occasions. I am sure if you have any questions or any issues, or you have any specific problem, there is a question answer session. You can ask your question and we will try to answer your queries. Thank you very much.
I now request Sri Pradeep Kumar, to our chief guest for this session, to please address us.
Honorable Chairperson, Co-Chairperson of Indirect Taxes Committee, the Bengal Chamber of Commerce Industry, distinguished delegates and trade representatives, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege to be here among all of you to attend a workshop which is very important, especially it deals with the provisions of GST, and also especially they are applied for exports. I thank VNCCI, the Indirect Taxes Committee, for inviting me today for the workshop, and organizing such a beautiful function at this location, which always feel that such event should happen much more here because a lot of concentration of industries and exporters are around in this place. As you are aware, what he mentioned, Bhurpur chapter is a Bhurpur commissionate, which consists of 6 districts of this West Bengal, both Pashchim Uttar Bardhaman, Purulia, Birbhum, Murshidabad, Bankura. So all this taken together is under my charge. So anything you feel in this area which requires any help, you can contact me or my officer, Mr. Chakravarti is here. He will talk in detail about various aspects of GST which will benefit you. Once again, I want to tell you that this area of West Bengal, this is districts, are very important as far as the industrial growth is concerned and even the exporters are concerned, because we have seen within 1 year or 2 years of GST leaps and bounds jump in the revenue collected for the government of India, and the number of registered SSC has increased many folds. So this shows that a lot of people here are now tax compliant, they are paying the taxes honestly. So just to tell you that we have around 1,22,000 SSCs, registered SSCs in these 6 districts. So this is a big number, and the revenue generated here is, we are, last year we have collected 6,750 crores of GST. This is a big number from this area, and the jump is around 45% from last year. So both ways you can see the quantum jump in the GST collection is increased 45%, plus number of SSCs is increased, plus we have more compliant SSCs here. As far as, because we being a GST implementation officers, we always not only facilitate the procedures, everything to help all the SSCs to comply with their norms, procedures, everything, but also we personally meet good big SSCs for us. As far as GST is concerned, SAIL is one of the biggest here. We have ECL, we have AC Cement, Imami Cement. Because in this area, iron, steel, cement are the main commodities, as you are aware. So, whenever, and we are organizing GST awareness functions also in different places. Hopefully, as it may be that the exporters, first time we see that he is organizing, that is very good, because this area also needs a lot of attention. And since we have one ICD here, plus a lot of refunds are being done whenever required by field formations, so any issues in such cases you can always come to us. But as a matter of caution also, I should tell you that some elements are using the facilities of GST to issue fake invoices to pass on invalid credit ITC to the other SSCs. So while taking any invoice or purchase invoices, you will always verify the authenticity of it. For this, there are many ways you can do it, because if you take it unknowingly, but tomorrow you may, because now that all the systems are interlinked, all data is online, so we have a robust management systems which always throw out the SSCs who are fake. And right now, today, suppose I am standing here in Bhurpur, I was last 3 weeks, I am in Calcutta handling 3 other GST commissioners. There also I found that Calcutta is becoming a hub of fake invoices, generation of fake invoices. So you should be very careful, especially exporters should be very careful. Credit app is coming in. It should not be like that, that we take a credit and then get the cash refund of the credit which was not valid. So this always you should take care, you should not get into issue later on, because these are all recorded transactions. And today if you see nothing happened, but tomorrow it may come back to you. This is one part. Second part is the procedure part, which all our officers are explaining properly. And I just inquired me, who are the participants? They said mostly exporters and some are traders and other, some of the service industry people are there, even real estate also. So in that case, there's another provision here. What we have is, that is anti-profiteering. There is authority here. GST provides that whenever there is reduction in rate of duty, there should be commensurate reduction in prices for the consumers, so the benefit is passed on to the consumers, especially in trade and industry. So it's happening at a lot of time, either willful or inadvertently, that benefit is not passed on to consumers. So where either we can make aware the traders or the service providers who are there to not to charge extra, or we can also make a complaint to National Anti-Profiteering Authority, which is available to anyone, so that such undue, unjust enrichment may not happen at the cost of taxpayers or consumers. In addition to this, not to say much, but the law has in the GST is very strict in a way that for persons who are doing good, honestly working, facilitate their things like anything. It's very far, very online. Some teething problems were there, mostly it has been resolved. New formats are coming, which will help you, all of you, to file returns easily. So in one more issue which we have observed in this area is people are not filing the returns in time, and sometimes it's delayed beyond more than 3 months or more than 6 months or up to a year also. If you don't file return as far as any SS is concerned, that means GST or 3B are filing it, so you cannot pay the duty. GST you cannot pay. That means you have filed GSTR1, that means you have created a liability, you have issued invoices, you have passed on the credit, but you have not paid because you have filed the next return, 3BD filing. What happens in such cases? The amount you retain, the government amount, you collect the GST, you don't pay to the government, which is happening in many, many cases around here. And for that, they have introduced a very strong provision in the GST law, section 132, which covers that if any due amount is beyond 3 months, it will be treated as an evasion of duty, evasion of taxes. So in such cases, if it is beyond 3 months and it is beyond 2 crores, then it is, you know, arrest provisions are there, beyond 5 crores, non-variable offense. So such things are in the act, but this is not to be, we don't exercise this very often, but we always persuade people to pay. You have collected, you should pay and file returns. Pay means if you file return 3B, then payment of Nyan Arthasa. If you don't file return of earlier months, you can't file return of next month. So you have to complete all the liabilities in sequence. So that is very important, because in all such cases, the owners, the proprietors, they are not very much aware of GST law and they depend upon their accountant or CA. And this is where the CA plays a crucial role. They misguide, misadvise people कि इसमें आपका फायदा होगा, आप सर्कुलर ट्रेडिंग कर लीजिए, मीन्स जमा खाता वहाँ से नॉइस लीजिए, आगे लीजिए सर्कल कर लीजिए, आपका बढ़ जाएगा, फ्रॉड नॉइस देंगे, आगे पासवर्ड करेंगे, आपका बैंक लोन मिल जाएगा, ये मिल जाएगा। बट वो स्मॉल पिकनरी बैंक शुड नॉट डू सच थिंग्स बिकॉज टुडे और टुमारो लॉ विल कैच अप एंड दैट विल देन आई फील सैड इन कोलकाता वेयर सिमिलर थिंग हैपेंड वेयर हस्बैंड एंड वाइफ आर देयर दे वांटेड लोन समबडी सेड आई विल गिव यू सम वैल्यू ऑफ इनवॉइसेस यू कैन जस्ट टेक एंड फॉरवर्ड इट टू further your asset that turnover value will increase. But later on we found that the invoices were given by the fake person who doesn't have any business, he just generates from the computer. So that way then they are in trouble, the CA guided wrongly to them. The similar thing may happen with anybody because as you feel ki you are getting some benefit, but this is very little benefit, but loss is much more. So don't go after such things and don't go into advices which are against the law. In Bolpur, just in Durgapur also we have one case I can cite myself also, that one person who has not paid 8 crores before GST implementation and then more than 12 crores after GST. He is collected but not paid and he is not bothered. Lot of installment facility was given to him. Persuasion of paper, we check this balance sheet or the bank statements. He has an income of 10 crores per month, but it's not paying from last 1 year. Then what to do? Because then we have to take caution whether that we have to just take help of 132. We want him arrested, that way this is not to any way to make you any feel bad, but this is the way law is there, but we it is discreet. Only when somebody is not following the principles, then the court said we pay first, then only we release. He has paid 4 crores until now, 6 crores will pay within 10. Now we will pay everything. He could have paid earlier also because he has an income, he can arrange. He has collected money, he has the money with him, he is misutilizing his funds. That is not correct. So he should not, because now everything is on online. So earlier days you forget about when paper documents don't match, immediately I can know what is happening anywhere in India. Anybody in the government, we can know. So data is very clear. Like this, this is for, I'm saying, the making them compliant for filing their returns and paying their taxes. But as far as export is concerned also, their similar IGST refund you get from customs immediately when the IGST is filed. So that way everything is streamlined. Earlier also it was there in ICS system. Similarly, it is being integrated now. Some issues, new formats are coming which may, in due course, may more simplify the things. But overall, with all of you here, I want to say that you should spread the message to all of your colleagues anywhere. And I myself, my officers, we have 3 divisions in Durgapur, one in Asansol, one in Vardhaman, one in Murshidabad. So we have all our offices everywhere where we have our help desk system also where we can help you out in case of any specific problem. But still what you need to do is do your own study also of salient provisions of the Act. Could be pertinent isme. And isme problem jo aati, you can even generate tickets online straight away and that is resolved very fast. So human interaction in the case system is very limited. So if somebody is saying something not happening for more than 2-3 days, 4 days, then you should contact that the person is not doing the right job, he is not logging the complaint properly or he is not following the complaint. So you should be very much aware of the facilities available. There are GST and website is there, you can track everything. So this is one part, and I'm grateful again to the organizers for allowing me to present my view to all of you, and I'm there to listen to you also. Specific thing I can, one to one, I can do that in my office here on telephone or an email, whatever it is possible. I am there with you, and in general, any queries we will answer after the session. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Honorable Commissioner Sri Pradeep Kumar, Mr. Chatterjee, Chairperson and Direct Tax Committee BCCI, Mr. Jalan, and learned trade representative. Actually, Mr. Chatterjee and Mr. Jalan will deliver their lecture on some specified subjects already you know, export. So I am not going to that issues that will be addressed because I know Mr. Chatterjee 2 years earlier. I shared bias with him at Kolkata and he is having profound knowledge and I also learned Mr. Jalan also. They have profound knowledge. So they will deliver lectures on specified issues of export. Today I am telling you about some basic compliance of GST because GST is going to complete in 2 years within a few days. But still now you will find that our compliance level is poor. How? Suppose a person has taken registration. So what they are doing, they are registering their principal place of business only, not the additional place of business. I have seen so many in retail sector, you will find here that hotel chains, restaurant chains and even West Bengal Tourism Development Corporation. And there are 2 units at Bolpur, one is Rangamitan and one tourist lodge. So I saw that in their registration, their additional place is not mentioned. But they are billing from Bolpur, they are charging taxes. How they are doing? As per Rule 10.1, you go through it. From REG 06, your additional place is also to be registered. And if it is not registered, suppose you are having a supply chain of food, you are having restaurant facilities at Kolkata, you are registered there. Now you want to open a restaurant at Durgapur. So what will you have to do? You will have to insert Durgapur place, additional place of business. Only then you can charge it, otherwise you can't. So I do not know. And second thing is that display of registration certificate, Rule 18.1. So you are learned friends, I think you have visited how many persons? Most of the persons are now registered. Commissioner sir has told the 1,22,000 registered SSCs are there in Bolpur. So how many you will find? They are displaying the registration certificate, REG 06. Few in shopping malls I have seen, and first they will sign in their signboard, they will write their registration number. They will have to mention the 15-digit registration number in their signboard. This is as per rule, but nobody is complying. Rule 18.1 and Rule 18.2. Nobody is complying. So a few persons are there. So this is the basic compliance. That should start from displaying registration certificate and writing the GSTIN in their signboard. Another point I like to mention here, we have detected one case, one complaint came, that a person was registered under composition scheme. But he was a restaurant service as well as hotel, renting of immobile property service. Prior to 1/4/2019, except restaurant service, no service provider was allowed to registration, opt for composition scheme. But he did it. And what he did? He charged GST. You are trade representative. Once, almost all of you are going to restaurants, and mainly retail chain and restaurant, you will find these things. They are collecting the taxes and they are not paying. I can mention you so many names. They are big shots. Haldiram, I can tell you. Gupta Brothers. Months together, KC Das. Months together, they are not paying. I have one app is there. If required, you can download it. Irish Peridot. From that, You can scan any documents, and if you focus the camera, they will show the filing status, GSTIN. First it will show snapshot. Second, it will show the person, character of the person. And we heard that some persons, they have taken registration, they are under works contract service, but they opted for composition scheme. So they are doing illegal things. So that person, what he did, being a composition person, as per rule 5.1, provision is there. First, he will write, he will issue bill of supply. In GST, after, if a registered person, he will have to issue invoice. That is the basic document, tax invoice. That is the basic document. I have seen Arambagh Food Mart. I think almost all of you have visited. They have stores. They are still writing cash money. After 2 years of implementation of GST, they are taking taxes on the basis of cash money. I made complaint several times, but nobody is hearing. Well, our chartered is actually dealing it. We cannot give you reply. I made normally these food chains, Beach Park, I am telling you, they have some shops just baked. Calcutta, I visited, I take one chicken cuisine and a cup of tea. So they are charging two rates, 18% for food and 5% for cup of tea as service. One is 2105 and another is 9963 service. Well, what is it? So their chartered replied to me, "Yes, sir, we are under mixed supply." What is mixed supply? Mixed supply, as per Schedule 2, you will find that restaurant service is a composite supply. So it can never be a mixed supply. So what they are doing? Actually, for food, they are getting some ITC. And to utilize that ITC, they are resorting to that practice. I have taken up the issues with the state authorities. So many things are coming. So divergent practices are being followed. For restaurant service from 15-11-2017, the rate has been reduced to 5% with no ITC. So they cannot take any ITC. But they are doing that. And for food product, they are again charging. Big Bazaar, you know, I visited it on 30-11-2017. I purchased one pillow, 9404. Earlier it was 28%, but from 15-11-2017, it reduced to 18%. So when I saw their bill, tax invoice, I saw they are charging 28%. What's the problem? And they are telling, well, we are a company of Kishore Biyani. You are resorting to malpractice. So many people gathered around me. And ultimately, after 30 minutes, their representative from Delhi made me phone call and they apologized and they refunded my money. So this is happening. Well, our software is not being updated, so charging. You see, the change came up from 15-11, from 30-11, or from all the stores. And people gathered around me. So as a customer, you should also be conscious before dealing with the GST things. So this is the basic thing. If you look at what they are charging, whether charging the taxes properly or not, this is the basic thing. Second thing, tax invoice. In GST, three documentation are there. First is tax invoice for any taxable supply of goods or service. Second is for exempted supply, that is bill of supply. Suppose a person is engaged in composition scheme, he is covered. So as per rule 5.1, what he should write? Composition taxable person, he should subscribe in his bill of supply. Composition taxable person not eligible to collect any tax, so that he may not dupe any person. I told you in Durgapur, one restaurant and hotel facility, now that person is absconding. State officers could not find him and he left his places, so he is absconding. So someday he will be arrested like that. But evasion is not so much of quantum. But thing is that they are collecting the taxes where they are not eligible to collect any tax. And people are also giving it without knowing. Second thing is that composition taxable person will display in their registration, in their signboard, composition taxable person. They will write that so that they may not due. So this is happening. And third document is delivery challan. That is for reason other than supply. These are the basic three documents that are required. Suppose you have one manufacturing facility as Kolkata and another at Durgapur. So you want to transfer your goods, because in GST registration is state specific, PAN based, state specific. And for a business vertical, you have option, you can take separate registration if you are separate business vertical, like IBC, they are having hotel business, they are having business of food products, so they are two separate vertical. If they are located, they are taking two single registration, so they are distinct persons. But if you want to send your goods outside the state having same PAN, then you are a distinct person, then you will have to take separate registration, because prefixing code will be changed. In West Bengal it is 19, in other state Jharkhand it is 20. So this is the thing, this is thing, basic thing. And for within the state, for any movement of goods, and I am telling you that regarding additional place of business also, very important thing. Suppose you want to avail some ITC, you have taken registration at Kolkata, your documents is showing that you are receiving the goods at Kolkata, but you want to receive some goods at Durgapur, but that additional place is not shown in your registration. So you are receiving the goods at Durgapur, so how you will avail the credit ITC? So this is the basic thing. So you should be aware of this thing. First of all, commissioners have also told, when you are purchasing any goods or any service for any B2B invoice, and I am telling you some specific features of invoice. Invoice, as per rule 46 of CGST rules, not exceeding 16 character, and only two special character is allowed, as hyphen and slash. No other special character is allowed. That is not exceeding 16 character and alphanumeric. And for a particular year, suppose current year is 1920, so that is to be inserted in that number, 1920 financial year specific. And after financial year, new financial year is coming, you will have to change that code. And you can maintain separate series also, one for home consumption, prefixing some letter H, for export you can mention E. And one interesting thing, I am telling you, Mr. Chatterjee will deliver lecture on export. The last year, you know, those who are exporter, some export benefits were locked. So what happened? In 6A, one table is there, GST or one return, that zero rated supply is to be reflected. Suppose a person has uploaded his invoice number there, but in shipping bill he is filing EDI, through EDI he is filing. In the invoice number he put one slash, so the system could not match that invoice. So you should be cautious for filing. Even space is also a character, you please note it down. And people are hovering here and there, they are, my benefit is locked. So in some cases, some facilities were there allowed by manually officers help, and some concurrent table that was to be given, or you have to amend the GST on one, that particular invoice number, otherwise that matching will not be done. And another thing I am telling you, now 3B and 1, these two returns are going up. So in 3B, one column is there, that outward supply, 3U1A column, for reporting your outward supplies other than zero rated, nil rated, exempted. And 3U1B for zero rated supply. In GST, export is zero rated. Export is zero rated. But you have reported that figure, that outward liability, in 3U1A, your benefit will be locked. Because that payment you have shown as a home consumption, so system will not allow your refund. So be careful while filing the return, otherwise your benefit of export. Normally, as per GST Act is concerned, if you file your shipping bill, that is the filing of refund claim. That is the date of filing of refund claim. As soon as you upload the shipping bill, you file, your return is assured. And system will take care of it. Through EDI system, they will match the figure with CB payment. I am telling you about the on payment of duty. And in respect of without payment of duties, you will have to approach the jurisdictional assistant commissioner for the purpose of refund. And that is also with the RNT01A, you have to file for import trade duty structure, you will get the refund here. So this is the basic thing. So you fill the column properly, otherwise your benefit will be lost. Now I am coming you that regarding registration, I am told invoice, issuance of invoice, posting, that I have told you the specific character of invoice. Now I am telling others, filing of return, very important thing. People are telling that commissioner service has told in Bolpur, we have detected so many cases that people are passing their ITC by filing GST or one return. And one provision I think you have seen also, section 29.2 provision is there. If a person fails to file his return for 6 consecutive months, so his registration can be cancelled by the proper officer. They have got the power. So what will happen? The person who has taken credit on the basis of some invoice, because from retrospective effect, that registration can be cancelled as per section 29.2. That much power has been given. But we are still not enforcing. State authorities, I interacted with them very recently, they were telling they are enforcing that provisions. So what is the thing? And they are telling some charters and these things, they are giving advice. You go on filing GST R1. But I am sorry to say you, GST R1 is not at all a return. It is a statement of outward supply. As per section 37, return was, word is not there. So return is, if payment is not made, it is not returned to our department. So the person who was filing GST R1, they are treated as non-filer to us. And we have arrested one person, one MD. Commissioner Sahab also told that his liability was 15 crores and he was not paying. And yesterday also we cracked one SSC. They were not filing the return from June 18. They have admitted their liability. Still we arrested. Because 132.1D, that provision is there. Because when you are a non-filer, but the amount, if it exceeds 5 crore and beyond the 3-year period of 3 months, it is evasion. And provisions are there. And GST, I tell you, if you do not file any return, that IPL provision is there. I means interest, P means penalty, RL means late fee. So these things will go parallel. So what will happen? Section 122 is there. From section 122 to 138, offenses and penalties are there. So if a person is not filing return beyond the period of 3 months, as per section 122, penalty provision is also there. As well as per section 132, prosecution provisions are also there. That will go parallel. So this is the thing. So if you are not filing your GST at 3B, actually you are skipping, you are not paying government duty. You are collecting the taxes, passing ITC and not paying to the government. So this is an offense. And I tell you, after logging your ID, now you say one bell icon is there. So please click on it. If any notification from the department, you will find, after logging your ID, you will find it, any notification from the government. So one section 149 one provision is there. You see, I think if you go open the registration of a person, compliance rating, now it is writing NA. So, days will come when government will give compliance rating. You want to purchase some goods from a supplier of goods or service. So, you can see his compliance rating. And whenever you travel outside city you are going, you book one hotel. So, what we see? Rating. So, in GST also, there will be rating from 1 to 10 on scale. So, if it is below 5, he is in danger. Don't purchase from him. So, he will be alerted. So, there will be some healthy competition. So, how? It will be fluctuating. That will vary. Suppose one person has not filed return, his compliance rating will be poor. A person has done fraud, his compliance rating will be poor. So system will make you alert. So days are coming while compliance rating will be given from your purchaser and this angle you will find. Now I am going to one interesting provisions regarding registration. Threshold exemption, you know. In GST threshold exemption is there. And another interesting thing is there. Earlier in central excise, one provision was there that the person who are exempted from registration under 8/2003 notification up to 150 lakhs, they could do job work also on behalf of others and they could sell. But in GST, only registered person can do job work. Unregistered person cannot undertake, cannot send his group for the purpose of job work. Those who are below 20 lakhs and a person who is registered, suppose a person is below 20 lakhs, he has taken registration. So he will be treated as a normal taxpayer. He will have to follow all the procedures. He cannot avail any exemption. But in central excise, the people who are below 150 lakhs, even though they are not liable to pay any duty, they could take registration and after crossing the 150 lakhs, they could enjoy the ITC and this thing. But in GST, there is no such scope. And another very old notification is there. I am telling you regarding job work of exempted person under 8/2003, 83/94 and 84/94. So that was taken care of. But in GST, only registered person can send their goods for the purpose of job work. So registration is very basic thing. And another thing is that if you do not take any registration, you cannot enjoy any benefit, any tax benefit, anything. Even if you cannot send your goods for the purpose of job work. And you know, another new notification has been issued from 1st April 2019, threshold limit has been increased. Very important thing. Service providers are not covered. For service provider, limit is still 20 lakhs. And so, who are eligible for these 40 lakhs? The person who is exclusively engaged in supply of goods. Only that person. Those who are engaged in exclusively supply of goods. I am showing you the slides and it will be clear. So there is some limitation, and if any service element is there, you cannot avail that threshold exemption and you will be debarred. And some products are there, that is ice cream, pan masala and tobacco. Suppose on grocery shop, what he is doing? He is selling tobacco products, you will find pan masala. So he will be debarred from availing this 40 lakhs exemption. Why? Because he has dealing some goods which are not allowed for extended benefit of 40 lakhs. Kirana shops, they are selling pan masala, tobacco products. So in their case, their threshold exemption is 20 lakhs only, not 40 lakhs. So be cautious. Some friends are there, some people are there. Those who are having this 40 lakhs benefit, So they should supply of service can be any kind of service, whether it is exempted or taxable, and would be immaterial whether amount received from such supply of service is rupees 100 or rupees 1 lakh or any amount. So you should be cautious. The person who are supplying is follows. Suppose we have some component of income from job work, income from service charge, interest from business loan and advances. Almost all persons, this will have commission income, rent from residential house property, receipt of check, disallowed charges. So these components, if 100 rupees you have received, you are not allowed to extended benefit of 40 lakhs. So this has come from 1st April 2019. Another is composition scheme. You know, composition scheme, this is a beneficial scheme for the small service provider or supplier of goods. So there are earlier it was there that on the total turnover tax was to be paid, but government considered for the MSME sector and extended the benefit for only taxable turnover from 1/1/2018. Now for the trader and manufacturer the limit is 1.5 crore, and for a student service 1.5 crore, and the rate is, I am telling you, for trader manufacturer 1%, but they cannot collect any tax from their customers. They cannot, they are not eligible to collect any tax. And for the student service it is 5%, they are also not eligible to collect any tax. But other persons, normal regular persons, how you know? If you go to his registration is to be applied, is to be displayed, or if you go through www.gst.gov.in or iris.peridot, it will show that there is a competition. Whether he is eligible to collect tax, it will show no. So they cannot collect any tax. So for student service composition taxpayer, it is 5%. Now for other service provider, those who does not want any avail any ITC, they have one scheme, 6% up to 50 lakhs turnover for small service provider. That scheme has been expanded from 1st April. And another thing, so this is the things I like to tell you. So compliance is a very important thing, and overall GST, so many things happen, system glitches were there, some problems were there, but still our council, GST council, they have come forward, they have solved the problem. And regarding interest also, so many disputes are there. Suppose you have wrongly availed some ITC, you want to reverse, so in that case your rate of interest will be 24%. In normal cases it is 18%. And one very important thing I am telling you regarding reverse charge mechanism, very important features in GST, reverse charge mechanism. And in reverse charge mechanism, so what is there, you know, for reverse charge mechanism two systems are there. One is some specified goods and specified service under section 9(3). In central excise, only one goods was covered under the first mechanism. That was molasses, as per rule 4(2) of central excise rule 2002. Only one commodity was there. No other goods was covered. But in GST, so many goods are there. Suppose a person is engaged in biri manufacturing, tendu leaves, you know, tobacco leaves. So they are covered in the reverse mechanism. The person who are receiving the goods, they are liable to pay under reverse mechanism. You know, in GST, agriculturist is exempted from registration. He is not required. So this is agricultural produce that is being produced by some agriculturist. They are exempted. The person who are receiving cashew nuts, that is under reverse mechanism. So reverse mechanism is very important thing. Why? In that case, the liability of taxation is shifted to the recipient. Suppose you have not determined your liability of reverse mechanism. After audit, department detects you make payment. So what will happen? You have to pay the duty, interest and penalty. So proceedings will be started against you under section 74. So if you go by negative list under section 17(5), any proceeding started by the department under section 74, 129, 130, so these three provisions are invoked by the department. No IDC is admissible. In GST, I am telling you, in Bolpur Commissionerate, we have done a commendable job. About 2 crores we have realized only by checking of electronic way bill. Very important features that has been effective from 1st April All India basis and 3rd June in West Bengal, 3rd June 2018. It was effective. So after 50,000, if the invoice value including duty exceeds 50,000 for interstate movement, UAB is mandatory. And one case was posted to High Court. The person approached to High Court and we confiscated his vehicles. Ultimately he has paid. For duty and penalty we asked. Now he had to pay 12 lakhs. For 2.5 lakhs we asked duty penalty, including all these things. But when he has gone to court, High Court, he had to pay 12.5 lakhs for default of, actually default was 1.25 lakhs and penalty was 1.25, 2.5 total. We approached him, asked him, but he missed the timeline. Earlier as per 129, 7 days time was there. Now it is 14 days. So if you fail to pay the duty penalty within that specified limit, section 130 will be invoked. We can confiscate the vehicle, confiscate the goods. We have power and we have done it in Bolpur. So people are now coming, well, sir, we want to pay. We have confiscated his vehicle. We have approached High Court. So what they are telling, we intercepted the vehicle outside the factory gate. One chartered came to me. Well, sir, it was 15 meter away from the factory gate. How he have intercepted the vehicle? I mean, whether it was outside or inside, court asked. It was outside. See, if it was outside and no documentation was there. He was telling, I have invoice. Well, okay, I do have invoice. Where is your bill? Invoice is the basic documents, you know it. But when movement is undertaken, UAB is must. If he does not carry any UAB, we can intercept the vehicle as per section 68 and as per 129, we can realize, charge them, pay the duty and penalty. So this is the basic things you should follow. I convey my thanks and gratitude to Bengal Chamber of Commerce and Industry and all the respected dignitaries present here and all the trade representatives. Thank you. I am concluding my lecture. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Now, any questions to the department, please?
So actually, say for example, small business house manufacturer, they do not have weighment system inside their factory.
So for example, I am a manufacturer. So in case I need a truck to be weighed, unless I get the total quantum, I cannot issue invoice. Now the weighbill is outside the premises.
That provision is there. Actually, you can send the goods for weighment for delivery challan, and that is to be delivery challan is to not exceed 16 character, and that is to be shown to your receipts other than supply. That provision is there. So you can take care of, and that delivery challan is to be mentioned in the tax invoice also. And actually, I remind you that as per GST or one, you will find the documentation what you are issuing, that is to be incorporated. Number, serial number of the documentation. So you can do that and you can disclose it to the department if you are facing such trouble. Earlier in central excise it was permitted outside if that weapon facility is outside. So where it is located, and I think for weapon purpose, no EOB will also require. That exemption is also there. 138. Rule 138, that provision is there.
Distance is there.
I think it is 20 kilometers. 20. No, 15 is for from transporter. 15 is from transporter. And it is, I think, 20 kilometers is there. So, you just inform.
So is it necessary to inform that?
Yes.
Initially.
I tell you. Yeah. Anything, I am telling you. And you know there are 16 beaches. You heard that system beaches were there. Some ITC benefit were locked, crores of rupees. People are moving hither and thither. So one simple advice I gave all the trade persons. Gee, you take screenshot before submitting, you take screenshot. That will be helpful. And you heard that government has allowed, gee, on 27-12-2012, you try in the system. And one commissioner sir also told, one help is there. Grievance and redressal, always posting. Whether it works or not, you take the screenshot of that also. That will be in the long run, that will be helpful for you. And people got the benefit. They produce that, have we tried through the system.
Okay.
Always you can do. Suppose I am telling you. Suppose you have removed one goods. You could not generate electronic bill. So what you can do? When you have planted it, you grievance and redressal. You just point out that we have raised such invoice, we could not generate your bill. So that will be recorded. And if any interception is made by the officer.
Is it possible that, say for example, I have to deliver a good urgently, and there is a power cut. So I could not generate that variable right at that moment. So maybe after 2-3 hours power is there.
No, that provision is not there actually. From mobile phone.
Yesterday only it happened to me. I had to deliver one truck and I had to detain the truck till the morning. Because of the weather condition, the power was not there in the factory.
Now, so mobile app is there. Everything is app-based.
Sometimes problem with the software also we face. Like one problem I am facing, say for example, I am submitting GSTR 1, GSTR 3,
before. No, if system problem is there, I am telling you, that grievance and redressal, you point out there, that will be recorded. Digital government will take care of. Suppose you cannot file in your return, some system glitches is there. So that will go to the authority. You can do that. And you take the printout of that. That I have such and such time, I have done it. I have informed the department.
What is happening, say for example, I have submitted all the returns in due time. Now say for example, I have 5 customers. So out of 5 customers, some people are able to see the entire thing. Some people are able to see half things and some people are not able to see anything. Now tell me the...
You are telling about GST 2A?
Yeah.
So what's the problem?
Problem is, say for example, I have 5 customers. So for one, I am submitting the entire details.
No, you are uploading all the invoices?
I am uploading all the invoices, I am uploading, maybe submitting all the returns. Now, out of 5 customers, some people are saying I am unable to see because they are also entitled to see what I am submitting to get that credit. Now some people are saying that I am not getting. Some people are saying I am getting partial. So I have 5 invoices, I am getting 3 and my rest 2 are not there. Some people are saying okay, I have got everything.
No, you can mail it to the system if required and I think they will redress. If system glitches are there, you can do it.
And who are unable to see, they are at a point of thinking that I may not have submitted.
The thing is that whenever you are making any redressal or things.
I have not done yet, but
I tell you, the www.gst.gov, I think link is there, you will find one. Grievance and redressal and issues can be given. You can give the snapshots also. That's you can post that, upload that documents also. Along with the screenshot. what is the problem they are facing? Any question?
In the lecture of Mr. Praveen, you have told that there is a fake invoices being produced in the market as well.
So, yes, yes.
Do we have any specific guideline or learning something on a specific on a portal that it should be avoided or people should not be?
I'm telling you, while making purchase, sorry, still.
Chances are there is fraud. This way. It is not paid is due for long period. All these fraud make invoices they only one by the GST or file credit, you file any credit. So you will come to know from that immediately it's going to be a fake, 99%.
If a person is a layman and he has the least knowledge of something getting trapped by something and like that. There should be a guideline which should be very specific for the layman language, because it is a pain something where you will identify from each one sitting over here that there is a gap between this.
This is a very important question. For this, we should issue a guideline to all. This is what we are feeling, how should you check? But what's important is not that you check, you know it. If you are taking a big invoice, you are aware. Because transport will not happen. Because the person is non-existent, address is fake, he is a provider. You will know, because you are indulging willfully to take the fake invoice. Mostly 99%. 1% chance that you have been defrauded. Woh bahut kam chance hota. But for that, we will issue guideline what to look for.
Actually, what happened, I am telling you, in GST, the total system is a trust-based. No physical verification of the premises is done before granting registration. And as per our rule, it is to be granted within 3 days. And the person is uploading the documents. What uploading? We have found that even bank document, that is also forced. Suppose he has written his HDFC account. Normally I have seen the person dealing with these things. I am telling you my experience. Those who are registered after GST, those who are not migrated. And actually this person is operating for a few months, 5 or 6 months. And how the data is being analyzed? Recently we got a data that Kolkata, in Barabajar, a person after taking registration in February 2019, for 2 months, he has issued invoice about 300 crores. So that person is 100% is a fake one. He is only passing. And when a system alerted us, the person has taken February 19 registration, and from February, March, he has every month he has issued 300 crores value invoice. So this is alarming. And thing is that self-trust that is being utilized. Document is not verified, he is giving red documents or any other agreements or these things, fake. So only Aadhaar and PAN, and they are also taking from some housemates, daily earner, wages earner, their KYC documents are being used. And another thing is that 3B is a self-declared letter and 3B is not linked to any register. I am telling you, suppose in 3B, ITC, you can show, Kalampur, you write 1 crore. Automatically, system will post 1 crore in your credit ledger. So this is the thing. So, what the people will do? People will create his liability for 1 crore only. So, what will do? That is plus minus. But he is not having a single invoice. But he has claimed ITC. Actually, he is not in possession of any invoice. In GST, as per section 16, 4 conditions is there. First is, he should possess the invoice. Second is, receipt of goods and service. Third is, the supplier should pay the duty. Supplier should file return under section 39, that payment return. So, 4 conditions to be satisfied. Only for bill to ship to, physical receipt of goods is not required. For bill to ship to, the person in whose name that bill is issued, credit will go to him. So this is the thing. So 16.2, very important, ABCD, conditions are there. So you check whether the person, and in GST, it is a one-way traffic. Whatever invoice that is to be issued by the supplier, recipient can do anything. Suppose after sale, any discount is to be given, anything is to be done. So that is to be done by way of credit note by the supplier. Any rejection is there, supplier, that supplier should issue credit note. And any price increase, debit note, that is to be issued by the supplier only. And debit note is also a specified document in GST. So earlier it was not allowed, and so many audit objections also raised. So you should be cautious while taking ITC, very cautious. The person who are registered in the GST, normally they are, I am telling you, proprietorship concern, mainly. I have said most of them are proprietorship concern and having showing a huge turnover. So this is, it should be cautious. Thank you.
Hello. Sir.
Sir is asking, please introduce yourself.
I said, Vijay Bajaj, Director Super Sakti Metallics Limited. A relevant question is on the capacity of our way bridge inside the plant is 50 tons only. One customer sends the truck to load the 60 tons. Suppose we are loading 60 tons. So what we observe, we cannot wait inside our plants. For 60 tons, we have to send the same bucket to outside the plant. Then what will be the procedure of making delivery charge?
Actually, this is the movement of goods other than supply. So rule 55 takes care of it. For other than supply, you will have to issue delivery charge. And that number will be not exceeding 16 character. And by incorporating that number in your GST R1, you will find first is invoice, second is delivery challan, debit note, that serial number, from this number to this number issued. And you just one intimation to your jurisdictional officer. And you are not required to also any generation of UAP for such movement of goods, because this is other than supply. So this is covered there, exemption is there. But some specified limits I have told you, that is there.
Thank you very much. We will take only one more question. If you have any other question, you can ask it.
Asking. Regarding job work, what will be the procedure?
Regarding job work,
the person is a registered person. He wants to send the material to other fellow. They are not the registered.
Whether you want to send the goods directly to his factory, who is not registered?
No, not from directly, from my...
From your registered premises.
From registered factory to send to the unregistered person.
You can do it, and by way of challan, you can send the goods. And there is also exemption from generation of UAV, irrespective of turnover. But actually, as you are a registered person, the goods movement will take place under your documentation. So yes, that is the thing.
Yes.
And when it will return, that will also come under, actually three copies you can make. Yes. And if it is come whole as one of things, so duplicate copy, they will return, they will endorse. Okay. And they can also have their own invoice, bill of that delivery challan. No documentation, other documentation is required.
So, UAV for both the way is not recommended?
No, UAV exemption is there. And we will reflect your movement. One ITC 04, one return is there. That is the disclosure, ITC 04. One return that is to be submitted, there is no penalty. That date has been extended up to 30th June. That has been extended, and there is no late fee, penalty, and these things for submission. you have mentioned the particulars where the goods are being sent. Oh, so this is the disclosure.
Now, when we submit this ITCR 1, when we have sent this material,
normal practice you do is, and quarterly you file ITC 04. You follow section 143, very important provisions, all things are covered,
section,
and some have both
section 143.
Section 143.
Sir, his job worker is unregistered, so I think a prior intimation is also required.
Now, prior intimation, that is ITC 04, that is the intimation. So, as per both circular,
that is ITC 04.
ITC 04 is the intimation. That is the intimation. That board has accepted it. That is the disclosure.
Sir, myself Bipul Panikri from Sam Steel, DGN Commercial.
Yes.
Sir, how to possible is the without invoice and without challan, they had the EY bit. Because the CCL and CL, they had the invoice delivery after 15 days. How it is possible? No action is taken in the GST department in CCL and CL.
I could not follow your question.
Regular basis, without invoice delivered the material, CCL and MCL.
CCL
and MCL.
Coal, coal from many.
Coal, coal.
Coal. So,
how to generate the invoice? The, without invoice, without invoice, you able to movement the material, is a long, is a 100 kilometers and 200 kilometers, 1000 kilometers, no action is taken in the GST department.
So, you take up the matter of the issue. So, if it is if we are a registered person in our
any private organization, the one truck is delivered the without EOIB, without invoice, the inform to the GST department immediately. But the number of rupees transaction is the without EOIB, the CCL and MCL, no action is taken in the GST department and no knowledge. How to is possible?
No. If you are tax compliant, if you follow the provisions of Rule 138, consigner, consignee or transporter. Anybody can generate electronically if required. You can generate.
Yes, sir. No, you so how the, after 15 days he is the invoice.
That is normal compliance. Please go discuss about this.
No. You are telling
you,
if you go by Rule 46, that specific provision is there. For supplier goods, invoice is to be raised at the time of movement of goods, and for service it is within 30 days. So that is provided in the rules. So you can take up the issues with the authorities.
One more question, please. This is the last question.
So what is to be done in case of F1 purchase if the material reached our premises and the EOIB has been expired? So what's the procedure to
for expiry of EOIB? Now the provision is there. You can extend. Before expire, that is 8 hours. Suppose night at 12, it is going to expire. So at 8 p.m., you can extend it. And after 4 p.m., in the morning, that is after, then it is also 8 hours from that expiry. After expiry, you can increase the your time.
If the time has been elapsed,
then no other alternative. You have to. And you can approach the commissioner also. And for specific cases, the commissioner has got the power.
Will that be sufficient for them?
No. For FOR's sake, I'm telling you, the consignee is responsible. And the consignor has got no responsibility. So, whatever the you will, actually, you will have to take the issues with your transporter. You should make them alert when you will is issued so that it is adhered. Actually, some if any unforeseen circumstances occur, some bond or these things, you can approach the commissioner also.
So, sir, in case of any assessment, if an assessment comes to our end and they found that the EOL has been expired but the gate entry or the GRN has been made after that, so will that assessment or the consequences will come on?
Consequence, actually, I am telling you, as per section 2ABCD, four conditions is there. So, receipt of goods. That is being supported by electronic web mail only, no other alternative. Invoice is the duty paid documents and EOIB is the movement of goods. So this is the basic documents. If audit people come, they will ask for that copy also.
So that has nothing to do with the EOIB bill?
No. They will ask for the EOIB bill. Whether,
with respect to movement only?
Yes, for movement.
No, sir, I think his question is that,
e-way bill has already expired. His GRM date is say 8 o'clock, but e-way bill has expired at 6 o'clock. Then during assessment, department finds this out. Then what would be
have the they have made objection regarding the receipt of
there could be a problem.
There could be a problem. Some legal issues will be there. You will have to satisfy to the authority.
Sometimes what happened, even if we had the time to modify or to cancel the way bill, but the supplier just hesitate to do that. They just deny outright.
In that case, you can reject the consignment and either cancel the credit note, and after that generate another invoice and send the goods.
I can tell you, so long your material has been physically received, duly supported by your GRN number, invoice number, transporter stated delivery charan, everything is absolutely correct. This sort of issues will be considered as a technical lapses.
Yes.
I am sure these problems you will face it in the departmental level. But you will certainly get a proper justice in the tribunal. Unfortunately, even in the presence of the commissioner, I am telling you, and we are all experienced, that we do not get any justice from the commissioner administration. I have been handling indirect taxes for the last 35 years, and my experience is that commissioner appeal is absolutely a place which is not required at all in the GST book or excise book or service book. You all agree with me. It is unfortunate, which is not there in the direct tax. I am handling both direct tax and indirect. So these sort of issues, I am certain that your so-called will be confirmed.
Thank you so much.
You will get the justice only from the tribunal. You have to wait for that. I am telling you a very clear one.
One short question, sir. In case of
sir, I want to respond to this. Because before joining Bolpur here, I was in Mumbai for commissioned use there. So I handled all this, and because there the issue was export of software and they get the refund of duty paid on inputs. So the services can put all refund. So there the issue was raised whether software is goods or not. If they are goods, then they don't get any refund. So we as a commissioner made a landmark judgment which was later on rules were amended, but we did the first. And around 20,000 crores of rupees were handed all over India. They got relief in that because of the major thing. Just I'm telling you what his experience is that in major cases it may happen. But now things are totally changed because as commissioner, I am also seeing the commissioner being sovereign in this area also, how they are passing. So we are thinking a lot of relief they are giving also, where there is very clear. Where there is some doubt, obviously they will not give because we cannot go beyond. The rules, the state can do, the tribunal can do anything, but we have to follow the guidelines. In that, we have to work there. But now, the relief is being made at the commission level, and that in favor and against the department is coming to 50-50. The current status like this. So, that way, his experience may be right, but things have been changed over a period of time. And as far as GST is concerned, we have now. That commissioner appeals, the level has been reduced to joint commissioner, and we have one more level, so they will handle PCDC and tribunal. Otherwise, they go to sustain. So the tribunal is being constituted for GST. There is again an issue. The right to file the appeal case of commissioner to the GST decides. So what I feel is in those cases where the expiry of e-mail is concerned, the only doubt which department has whether in this period whether it will be utilized twice or thrice or not. That is only doubt. That we have to satisfy that it is coming out a long distance, cannot go and come back again. This is only what is we can say situation is to be investigated, it is to take up. So if the goods, what he has said, goods have come, everything is alright, nothing will happen. That's very true. And the relief need not be at the level of tribunal, can be at the level of commissioner later also. Because I feel most of the people here also, I am here for so many months. Hardly I have met or talked to anybody. Nobody comes to my office, nobody speaks to me. I want to reach people to talk to them.
So that's also great. They are only interact with the lower level inspector superintendents, which are not very much aware of law, and they are afraid of, then they will always say, yes, any yoga, any yoga. So always approach assistant commission, deputy commissioner, or the higher as commissioner I am there. So things will be resolved. If somebody comes to me, it will be resolved very rightly. Understand? And this is true not for me, but all the senior officers and all of India. You have to approach the right, I mean, the higher up to Dana Prega if you are not satisfied with the lower level. That approach has to be in your mind also, and should not feel any constraint or anything that afraid of or anything. Why you should not go for commissioner? You should go. Take appointment, take thing, you can speak on, or you can send mails, fax, whatever. Because we always respond. Now things are very transparent, and things which I feel or anybody senior level feels things are not being implemented properly or not communicated properly, I have to take a corrective measure in that. So I feel as I feel I am not doing my duty well, but I need to get inputs so that at least such impression should not carry forward much, and as a hota, I should inform, because I am not getting any information of it later. So I will be grateful if such thing comes, you can come, he is there, always you can say that he can talk on any topic. My assistant commissioner is very much learned, he is a trainer in our department on GST issues, and we discuss a lot. He is aware, Bolpur is a very small town where I live in a guest house just above the office. So my office and are in the same building, so I am 24 hours available. And secondly, and we sit in the night and discuss all these issues. How to resolve these things? We are, because GST law is new, we are also learning and resolving the issues. So trying the things out, we can inform our junior officers to implement things properly. So what we need a feedback from you as far as possible, as much as possible.
The chat people bulai se raja hai kya?
Hain?
The chat people ko bulai aaj
chat. इधर यही से अपने एसोसिएशन के मेंबर वी हैव डिस्कस के में रखना है आसनसोल में रखना है या रखना है वी हैव डिस्कस के मतलब आई एम देयर हम आपके पास आ जाएंगे यू आर ऑलवेज वेलकम चाय का खाना भी खिलाएंगे आपको नो इश्यूज ऑफ दैट बट वी शुड बी इंटरेक्टिव वी शुड नॉट फील एनी बैरियर बिटवीन अस दैट्स व्हाट आई एम सेइंग
फ्रेंड्स वी हैव ऑलवेज
योर हेल्प डेस्क इन दुर्गापुर इज वेरी पुअर हेल्प डेस्क ऑफ दुर्गापुर ऑफिस इज वेरी पुअर
हां दैट वी हैव टू
सो यू मस्ट इंप्रूव दिस
Mr. Chakrabarty is there, you can always meet him and you are seeing that how knowledgeable he is. Sir, can we take your questions separately? Because what absolutely we have no time. You just see our program, please help us. But it is good that long discussions has taken place by the Honorable Commissioner and Assistant Commissioner. Many questions he has replied. I know there are certain issues, but we have long programs on exports and other basic issues. Thank you very much, sir. We are grateful to you, and many thanks to Mr. Chakrabarty, who has really played excellent in this particular workshop at the beginning. So thank you very much, and we break for 5 minutes.
Thank you, sir. Before that,
we have no time at all. Actually,
we have a pleasant task to
perform. We have a pleasant task to.
I now request our chairperson to please hand over a memento to the commissioner on behalf of Bengal Chamber. And also to our assistant commissioner, please. Photograph together, please.
One and a half years or 2 years, where we found a lot of problems,
and how we have taken care of these problems. So those are the basic issues we'll discuss today. And if and one of the most important issues is the assessable value, or you can say transactional value. Here we have faced lot of problems, and we are expecting major problems in this area, which whatever we'll touch upon today. Assessable value, you know that most important thing is that our all GST or excise or service tax, it is all ad valorem. That means value is a very important area. And as per section 15 of the CGST Act, the value will be the assessable value, that is the transactional value. But here there are a lot of issues are here. What do you mean by transactional value? And wherever the parties are interested, wherever the transactions are made between two parties, wherever there is a related party transactions, how the valuations will be made? How the valuations will be made when goods are transferred from one company to another same company, within the same company but located in different states, that is inter-unit transfer of goods? How the valuation will take place? These are all not very clear in the GST law or GST rules. No, based on our experience, we will try to share with you. I will give one example. Particularly in the FMCG segment, you will find, or even in the automobiles, you will find, in the white goods, you will find that you return your goods. On used goods, in reply to that, in exchange of that, you get another total new goods. If you return, say for example, a second hand air conditioner, you want to get it replaced by a new air conditioner. The air conditioner's price is say 40,000 rupees. But if you return the old air conditioner, the value comes down to 30,000 rupees. The question is that the transaction is taking place. I am talking about a big company. It is around 12,000 crore company. They considered it that the valuation is 30,000. Because they get 30,000. Although the valuation is 40,000, but they are getting the return of the old one and supplying it the new one, the value is reduced to 30,000 rupees. I am telling you, in many such cases, take one, buy one, get two, these sort of transactions are quite rampant in our business day to day. Now, the question is that whether GST is applicable on 40,000 or 30,000. Now, GST rule is very clear that it should be in a barter system or a partial barter system. In a barter system or partially barter systems, the assessable value should be considered as the gross value and not 30,000 rupees. This is one area which we have experienced and I am sharing it with you. Therefore, whenever any such transaction takes place, you have to consider the price at arm's length. You have all aware about the fact what is known as arm's length price. Arm's length price is a price which is not influenced by the relationship or any special conditions. I will give one more example, and it is very much rampant in the trade. Again, in the FMCG segments, white goods segments, that my agreement or arrangement, whatever I am telling you, these are all facts. Not any ambiguous examples or anything like that. This we have all handled in the farm.
Now, normally many agreements are made with the distributor, between the distributor and the manufacturer, that I will supply you these goods to you at X price. But the entire advertisement cost, marketing cost has to be borne by you. Is it clear to you? For example, you are selling your white goods. I am just giving an example. Say for example, Samsung. It's just an example. Or Bajaj pens. That's very good. They have 30,000 dealers in the whole country. Bajaj has a consideration that region wise that you have to bear the additional cost on account of advertisement in the eastern region, which is the stockist, which is the sole sensitive stockist, western region, southern region, northern region. My advertisement budget is 200 crores, out of which 100 crores you have to spend, and this much amount of money I give you, it will be taken care of. Now, valuation law says that if I have any obligations to spend, but if I shift it to others, that shifting amount should also be added into. You have to be very careful about these sort of arrangements. And these are very common. That means marketing activities, marketing the product, the responsibilities for marketing the product rest with the manufacturer and not the distributor or dealer. So therefore, if the dealer is bearing the cost, it will be assumed that that amount of money you have reduced from your sale price. And accordingly, the tax will be paid on the gross amount and not on the net amount which is. So therefore, you must be knowing that transaction value is one word, transactional value. But you have to understand the true meaning of the transactional value. If the obligations of the manufacturer is shifted to the dealer or distributor, this is very quite, very, you must have seen that. That is not to be considered as a transactional value. The additional cost being borne by the distributor or dealer is to be considered as a consideration on the part of the manufacturer. And that amount, these are the potential areas which you are expected to face with regard to adjudication areas. And again I am telling you, I have told you in presence of the commissioner, you have to be very, very careful about the documentation part, date part, and expiry part, because we have hardly any scope to get any justice from the department, which you are all experienced. So therefore, any exchange of a warranty, another big area I am discussing. This is also faced. Sometimes in a capital goods industry, the norm is that, say for example, a power plant or steel unit manufacturing unit. One of our clients, they construct a steel industry, the entire steel mill, including blast furnace, everything, blah blah blah. And as per terms of the contract, that if there is any defect in the supply or in the functioning of this entire plant, the EPC contractor will replenish the defect. He will make good the entire free of charge. Now question is that, in such incident, in such case, and this warranty period is given for a period of 4 years. During this warranty period, say for example, something happened and the company is supplying the goods to the steel making company free of charge. What will be its impact in the valuation? Question is that whether GST is payable on such supply? If yes, why? If no, yeah. Because GST is applicable on supplies. I am going to discuss only these critical issues which we are facing. Now, these 4 years is a long term. During this period, the unit may face a lot of problems for which the EPC contractor is liable to supply the goods free of cost. Now, the answer of this question is that no, there is no, but I am sure that would be an issue. From the departmental point of view, department will say supply free or against warranty will be subject to payment of GST. Whereas our consideration will be that when I have charged for the supply of the EPC contract, we have already included the cost of warranty within the our sale price. And on the total sale price, we have paid the GST. That means there is nothing free. I have already got the money in advance at the time of supply, because my costing is inclusive of warranty cost. So in such cases, when I am supplying the goods again, there is no question of further GST. My suggestions will be, when you will, this warranty issue is a very common issue to all industries. Free supply could be of two types. One is for sales promotions and another is for meeting your warranty commitment. If it is against warranty commitment, there is no question of payment of GST. But you have to make sure that due intimation is given to the department that you are going with this valuation principle with complete justifications, so that the department cannot claim that it has not been informed. But when you are supplying goods free as your marketing technique, it is normally required, particularly in exports, in domestic, particularly in the pharmaceutical industry, we have a lot of compliance. They say, sir, it is a part and parcel of our business. So much percentage of our total sale, I have to distribute free. Otherwise, not a single pharmaceutical medicine can be sold. Tell me, what should I do when I am supplying the medicines to the doctor without any charges, forget about the GST, how should I deal with that? Now, if you go to the valuation rules and section 15, they have made it very clear that free samples, distributions, everything on which you are not entitled to get input tax credit, section 16. And therefore, you have to, in case of free supply, free distributions, buy one, take two, all these issues, you have to calculate what is the accrual value of the ITC which you have taken. And there you need to calculate that what is the amount of proportionate ITC which is applicable to the free supply of goods, free sample FOC, free of cost. That amount has to be reversed from your ITC and it should be intimated to the department again. And basis of your reversal should be made very clear. So this is another area on APOC type of material which you may face in future. Now one more important case has come, unfortunately or fortunately, Asia Columbia case. It is a advanced ruling department, advanced ruling. They say it is another area. As far as this advanced ruling, appellate authority, mind that advanced ruling has got two stages. First you go for advanced ruling, if you don't agree, then you can file an appeal. Now appeal has confirmed that for any organization, there is a head office. Head office renders services to its various branches. It is Asia Columbia case. Asia Columbia has around 9-10 diagnostic and hospitals all over the country. It is a Singapore based company. Now they have their head office. Head office does lot of jobs on behalf of the branches. Now in the Asia Columbia case, it was decided that the services of the HO people, again I am repeating, this is a very dangerous case, and appellate authority has confirmed that services of the head office people, that is their employee salary, commissions, everything will be proportionately distributed to their all branches. Although it is a revenue neutral, but you can understand that services provided by the employees are considered to be an exempted from the provisions of the GST. It is very much clear. But in this particular advance ruling, appellate authority confirmed that yes, this head office is supplying services. So therefore, this is applicable. All of us are affected because of this advance ruling. Now, about 3-4 days back, I got a message that against that, the appeal has been filed, most likely in Gujarat High Court. Gujarat High Court, and no stay has been granted by the High Court. This is a very dangerous profession. Everybody has got the head office, and head office is being to deliver services for his branches. So all services provided by the head office will now be chargeable. If High Court confirms, that it becomes a law. So this is another area of great concern in the GST provisions. Motor vehicles. We all know there are certain restrictions on motor vehicles with regard to the taking of credit, because it is nothing but a personal use. But there are some instances when motor vehicles are used for providing services against which you charge GST, like in courier services, banking services, ATM services, where motor vehicles, transportation services, there motor vehicles are a part and parcel of the business. Excepting in those cases, motor vehicles, credit on motor vehicles are not available. We have got a very interesting case. It is one of the very reputed central government organizations. They have set up a motor vehicle shredded unit. You will be facing, but it's a very new area of business. That one joint venture with Mahindra has been set up, that all second-hand motor vehicles which are not usable at all, which are not usable at all, which are normally goes to the Panavar type of areas, that will be threaded through a threading machine. And those threaded steels, they will have a separate system of collecting steel, collecting plastics, collecting rubbers separately, and those threaded steels will be sold to the steel manufacturing company. That means it will be recycled. This sort of system is unheard of today in India, but it has come, a new unit has been set up in Noida. They will be purchasing through auctions or through bidding these unused, non-usable motor vehicles. It will include two-wheeler, three-wheeler, four-wheeler, transport trucks, etc. This, I think we have got it. This issue we have got it recently, about 2-3 days back. These central government PSUs wants to know whether in these cases they are entitled for ITC credit or not. Because motor vehicle is already appearing in the negative list, block credits. There they did not make it very clear. They could not even imagine that these sort of things can come. Now our explanation is that when scrap vehicles are coming, it is no more a motor vehicle. It is no more a motor vehicle because you cannot use these scrap vehicles as a vehicle. So therefore, the negative covenant which is there in the GST law under section 16 and 17 with regard to the motor vehicles will not be applicable. And all GSTs which are available as credit will be available as credit in spite of section 17.5 of the CGST Act. Because here you are generating revenue. When you are selling the shredded steels, you are charging taxes. So therefore, input and output both will be applicable. I give you one more very important case, and it is a historic case that has been decided. All of us know that no credit available on immovable property. The recent Gujarat High Court, I have seen Gujarat High Court always gives a very good and important judgments. Say for example, this is a hotel. While constructing the hotel, they purchased steel, cement, was contract, everything they want. Now under GST law, the ITC credit is not available on was contract, which is immovable. That means to construct this particular hotel or restaurant, whatever you may call, no GST is available. But the services which you are providing from these hotels are all taxable. In such cases, whether this negative clause will apply or not. And the High Court has given a very important judgment that no, this hotel is to be considered not as building. This hotel is to be considered as plant and estate. Have you heard this sort of judgment that building is considered as a plant and estate? So therefore, you are using a plant to generate your revenue. So therefore, you cannot deny the availability of ITC credit. Friends, these are the case laws which you have to go through. It may not exactly be your case, but you can take the spirit of the case and apply it in your case. Another important judgment has been given in the employees' welfare cases. Many companies have a canteen facility. And in the canteen, the free foods or concessional foods are supplied. The question is that whether these will be considered as services or not. Employer does not have any intention to make any profit. These services or these facilities are provided to encourage the employees to work, and sometimes it is to qualify the Factories Act regulations. You must be knowing that companies, factories which have total strength of more than 250 employees, their provisions of compulsory canteen is there. Now department say, yes, you will provide the canteen. I am not asking you not to. How the adjudication comes? Now I am telling you. I have handled this case. When I took the matter with the North Block, they said, yes, it is under the law, you provide the canteen. But who said? Canteen means you have to provide at least three supplies. Canteen means a place for fooding, for enjoying or taking rest. That you do that, I have no problem. My question is that you are providing the foods and maybe charging 20 rupees, 30 rupees, 40 rupees. Yesterday we had faced this issue in Excite Industries Limited. They also asked me, Professor, what I will do for that? Now, recent advance ruling said this is to be considered as services. Now, a real problem comes. If you have 1,000 employees and everybody takes food every day, are you obliged to issue a tax invoice? Then every day 1,000 employees into 26 days, 26,000 if you have 1,000? Our answer is that yes, it is to be considered because it has been already, the rule has already been passed and department has also accepted. In that case, you can raise one invoice per unit per month. Your compliance will be full. So, in one case, we have seen that what I am telling you, these are already facing by you. Because most of you have a factory, and in the factory, you are providing concessional foods or free foods. Now, the question is, what about valuation? Food cost is 100. You are charging 10 rupees, a nominal fee. If I consider as a transactional value, if I consider section 15, then your total value has to be considered. Because 20 rupees is price is not at arm's length. 20 rupees is a concessional price. Your actual value is 100 rupees. So department may ask your question that charging GST on 20 rupees is not sufficient. But this matter is still kept open. So you have to take your own decision. But in most of the cases we have suggested the cost of the food to be considered as the total value, and based on that you have to pay the GST. That should be the way you should interpret if you go through section 15 of the CGST Act. Now, these are the current issues which I have discussed, and there are many issues which we will discuss in the second part. Other than these things which we have already discussed. Now, I discuss a very important topic today about the classifications. I am not taking the help of any slides, which we have all many slides, but time. time is not there. There are many slides. I cannot skip that way. But I want to discuss these classification issues very clearly. Now, how classification is made, we must know that. Why I have to know about classifications? Because based on the classification, the rate of tax is applicable. First advice is that where we make a lot of mistakes, that we go with the HSN classification and feel, say for example 3215 is an item which is applicable for paints. Now there can be varnish based paint. They are also applicable under 3215. Solvent based paint that can be also appear under 3215. Solvent free paint, that is water based paint. Just put the water, it will be painting. Nowadays lot of things are coming. This is also paint. Many of us have a feeling that if the chapter heading is compliant, 3215 or 3212 paints and varnish, rate of tax will be the same. Whether it is big paints, whether it is a solvent based, whether it is a solvent free, these concepts are totally incorrect. Even within the same classification, the rate of tax might be different. I will give a very good example. 4819 chapter, it deals with the fly ash rigs. It also deals with the fly ash blocks. But if you feel 4819 is a fly ash brick, applicable rate of tax is 5%. But again, 4819 fly ash block, it is 12%. So, friends, never see the HSN classification. You have to see the HSN classification to identify the rate. But at the same time, in the same classification, there can be 2-3 products. Now, if I ask you how to read the classification, this is a conceptual issue which I will try to share with you. How classification is made? We all know HS classification stands for harmonized classifications. Who fixes these classifications? Not by the government of India. These classifications are made by World Custom Authority, WCA. Where it is located? It is located in Brussels, in Belgium. Around 195 companies, 90 countries are the members of the WCA. When you enter into a WCA signatory, you have to comply the harmonized classifications up to 6 digits. That means 6 digits you cannot change. Only next 2 digits, that means 7 and 8, you can change. Now suppose anybody has come to you to understand what is the tax for a particular product. Obviously what you have to do? You have to first understand what is the classification. The question comes, how do you know the classification? There are a few millions of items. Which particular section or which particular chapter we will see? Now you have to understand how to see the chapter. This is a very preliminary thing, but if you understand, it will help you a lot. First two digits basically talks about the groups or chapters. That means suppose you have to classify rice. Mind that rice classification will not come from the first two headings, first two numbers. From first two numbers, say for example 1-1 stands for cereal. Since rice falls under cereal, the group of the product will first start. That means chapter. Under which chapter, under which group the product falls. That means first two digits will not specify your product at all. It will only indicate under which group you fall. That means rice is a part of the cereal. Similarly, in the same 1-1 chapter, you will find lentils, you will find wheat, you will find everything. Which are come. So first two digits stands for the group or under which chapter, under which you are thought. You have to know around 40-50 chapters. That if you come to me and say, sir, this is a plant and machinery. Immediately I know the group of plant and machinery is which one? 84 or 85. I will not see 1-1, 1-2, 1-3, 1-4. If you come to me and say, sir, this is a plastic item, then where should I go? I go for 3-9 chapters. Then, so first two digits I have come to know. What is the next two digit? Next two digit, say for example, rice. 1-1, 1-2. 1-1 is a cereal and 1-2 is a rice. So first four digit. Now WC has given up to 6 digits, another 2 digits. What is that? Rice can be a coarse rice or rice can be a polished rice. So 1-1, 1-2, 1-3 is a coarse rice, 1-1, 1-2, 1-4 is regard to polished rice. Up to this stage, WC has closed it. Now depending on the country, you might go for further classifications. In India, classification of polished rice are also some Govindabhog rice, non-Govindabhog rice, so like that you can expect. But up to the 6 digits, these digits, that means cereal, rice, coarse rice, up to this number is completely fixed. That if you have to go for a classification, what you have to know? You have to basically know the group. Then classification is very easy. Should I continue further or another? Two more important things I discuss. Time is a very big problem here. Composite supply and mixed supply, very delicate issue, and most of your problems will come here also. I have a very easy way of explaining what is composite, what is mixed. Many of you will mix both, and I can tell you 60% of the advance ruling is with regard to the composite supply. In a composite supply, what we get, that it is a bundle supply. Mixed is also a bundle. So, two things are same. Mixed is also a bundle and composite is also a bundle. But in a composite supply, there is a principal supply. Whereas, in mixed supply, there is no principal supply. All are principal. But at the same time, it is bundled. I will give an example. You are setting up a blast furnace. But while setting up a blast furnace, you are also, blast furnace is a bundled item. With blast furnace, you have maybe 100 ancillaries, which are basically helping blast furnace to work. They are independent, but when you are supplying a blast furnace, you are sending, giving the blast furnace along with LCD supplies. That means in this particular supply, there is a principal supply. And in that case, the principal supplier's rate will apply for everything. I am giving you an example of solar cell, which we have handled very recently. One of our clients, Exide Industries, I can tell you, they are doing for EPC contract of solar cell. Solar panel. They are installing solar panels. In a solar panel, 65% of the supply is the solar panel, and balance 20% are on account of batteries, 85, and 15% is the works contract. You see, 65 plus 20, 85% is the supply, out of which 65% is the solar panel, 20% is the other ancillaries which are required to function solar panel, that is battery, and 15% is the construction part. That means you have to pay. Now tell me which rate will apply. Now if I consider the construction part, that is works contract, it is 18%, whereas the solar panel attracts 5%. This is a very, now advanced ruling, there are 5 advanced rulings, 4 advanced rulings. These advanced rulings, I can tell you, these are all completely biased with the government. They are nothing but the departmental people. Out of 5 advance rulings, 4 advance rulings were given stating that the rate of on EPC contract for solar will attract 18% rate. Although the installation part is only 15%. Please understand that. And Exide called us and said, Mr. Chatterjee, if we have to pay 18% on the full value, then this business is not viable. Nobody will buy us by paying 18% of the total value. Our buyers are mostly college, universities and big things. We have analyzed technically, this we have filed it with the department in the North Block. Now, we found only 15% is the constructions. And 80%, 85% is supply, out of which 65% is the principal supply, that is solar cell. We say this is nothing. The advanced ruling said it is a mixed supply. We said it is nothing, it is not a mixed supply, it is a composite supply, where the solar cell is the dominant factor, is the principal supply. Department has accepted. Now out of 5 advance rulings, 4 advance rulings against us, they all say, no, it is a mixed supply. In a mixed supply, the advantage is that the highest rate will be applicable no matter whether it contains 1% or 2% in the total supply. This is a fact. So therefore, the department accepted and they came in between and came out with a very peculiar solutions. If you go to the tariff, you will find that in case of solar cell, 70% will be applicable at 5%, and 30% will be applicable at the rate, 18% will be applicable on 30%. That means rate of tax is now 8.3%. Although there is no 8.3% in the tariff rate in the whole GST. They said, Mr. Chatterjee, 30% will ask for 18%. You said 15%, but according to us, 30% is the construction and 70% is the supply, we will consider at 5%. So 3.5 is equal to 8.3%. Now we have again taken up, we said no, supply is 85% and construction is only 15%. And said, yes, it is a clear case of compulsory. Be very careful. Now the question is that what is known as mixed supply? I am taking the help of a one very good example. This is not there in the books. It is there in my books. How it is differentiated? In a mixed supply, everybody is invincible. Whereas in this composite supply, there is a dominant supplier. I will give a very good example of a mixed supply. During Diwali, you must be getting some type of presentations or souvenir from your clients. It contains many things. Nuts are there, cashews are there, drinks are there, chocolates are there, biscuits is there, and they make one item and price is one. No separate, when you go and buy the item, it is only one price. Here you see, although 7-8 items are there, all supplies are principal. There is no dominant one. There are all supplies, Cadbury is same. So, in a mixed supply, you will find it is a one price, presentation is one particular classification, but the products which are available, they are all principals at all. There nobody can say, I am the principal, he is the residual. So, the difference I am telling you, these are the most important areas which we will find in the days to come in the areas of valuation and classifications. And in the classification, major areas will be the composite supply and mixed supply. Why? The department's intention will be always to classify it as a mixed supply. In the mixed supply, the advantage is that the highest rate of the item will apply, although it may contain only a fraction of the total issue. So you have to be very careful. And I always suggest to my clients that whenever you go for any classification, you please give the classification with justification. Where there is a dispute, you please give this classification with their justifications to the department so that they do not say that we did not know you gave classification. Another area which Mr. Chakravarti has already handled, that is a very important area of reverse charge mechanism. We had been around 400 audits of various companies. Now, if you ask me which in the audit, which are the major areas you have found, I will tell you in one area which is common to everybody is the RCM. This was quite on. Second is the valuation. Third is the warranty. Four is the FOC. These are the common areas which we are finding problems. Classification is also another area. Now RCM is, the problem is that if you do not pay the RCM is a revenue neutral, we all of us do. But many times we do not classify in RCM. You have two documentations. One is for self-invoice you have to raise. Many companies do not raise the self-invoice. Here is the common problem that you have to raise a self-invoice with regard to the RCM. And you have to know what is the time of supply of RCM. And the time of supply is different from goods and services. So therefore, time of supply, that is date of receipt of the goods in case of RCM for goods or invoice date, whichever is earlier. Normally, you will find the invoice date is earlier. On that day or the receipt of goods, whichever is earlier, you have to raise the sales invoice. Secondly, they do not consider it as an RCM. There is no proper accounting and documentations of the RCM. I will tell you, at the time of our audit, first area of checking will be your delivery challan. You just note down tomorrow. And after 1 year, when I will come, you will just reconcile. First, the auditor will come and say, you show me your list of delivery challan. Because delivery challan is an area where you are supplying goods without payment of GST. So they will see whether delivery challan has been rightly used or wrongly used. For example, ITC 04, that is the job worker. The job worker returned quarterly, whether input-output ratio has been properly met. I am giving you a good example. So I was 35 years in the organization. I know where are the weaknesses. You are giving certain items to your job worker. Say for instance, a chemical product, where you will never receive 1:1. You are giving 100 kg of chemical, finished item you are getting 95 kg or 98 kg. 2 kg per 100 is a common loss. Have you finalized the input-output ratio at the time of agreement? Is your processing agreement has a specific provisions that if the loss percentage is more than the status limit which is specified between the contractor, and what is the industry norms with regard to the input-output? This area probably you have forgotten. And here will be the patient. When you will go for input-output check that you have sent 100 kg and got say 90 kg, the department action will be, it is a calendar style removal. You have actually lost 2 kg, 8 kg you have sold at a cash, by cash. Suddenly you will come, so why is the question? I have got 90 kg. So what is the norm you tell me? Is there any such clause in your processing agreement that what will be the norms? If you have a proper discount, then turnover discount, cash discount, incentives, etc., etc. These are all basically transferred in the form of credit note. In the form of credit note. Now question is that whether these credit notes will have the GST component or not. The answer question is that whether the credit note on account of trade discount or turnover incentive will have a GST component or not. Department will ask you the only question whether these incentive or commissions or discounts are as per your pre-sale agreement or not. If you say, sir, how do I know that how much amount of discount I will offer him? It depends on the turnover, it depends on the so many things. No. Your agreement with the dealer, your agreement with the distributor should have a specific provisions that your invoice value will be further subjected to discount, trade incentives, quantitative discount. And we have advised for all clients that your invoice must contain that this invoice is raised which is subjected to further discount, incentives, commissions as may be decided by the company in terms of agreement dated such and such. If you do not write this in the invoice and simply issue the normal invoice with trade discount and there is no agreement, when you issue the next credit note for passing these benefits, you will not get the GST benefit. And this is as per perfect law, you will not get any justice or equity from the tribunal. Because law is very clear, pre-GST discount, pre-sale discount will be allowed, not post-sale, unless and until it is specified in the In the areas of debit note and credit note, I have also important point to pass on. Suppose I am asking a question that you want to charge some liquidated damages to the customer. What invoice, what documents do you raise? Invoice, debit note, or some other document? Can you tell me, anybody can volunteer? That what document you will raise? You have so many documents available. One is called invoice, another is called bill of supply, another is called debit note. These are the documents are available. Now, if to know that, you have to read section 34. There says any debit note and credit note should be in relation to the supply. That means damages for some other purpose. Say, for example, they have not provided you the space on time. This is no way connected with my previous invoices. Where you do not have any link with the invoice, there you cannot raise a debit note. They are only question of invoice. So therefore, any such type of charging, say out-of-pocket expenses, like penalties, commissions, anything, you have to take the help of a free total invoice and not in case of debit note and credit note. Debit note and credit note should always be in relation to the previous supply. So in the case of debit note, credit note, we have learned that any discount, incentive, commission should always be pre-sales agreement, supported by pre-sale agreement. You may not quantify the exact rate, but the agreement should have a provisions that the supply can go for further incentive. If you don't have that agreement, we will not get the credit. Friends, I conclude here, and in the after debate, you are ready now, I am concluding. It is already 2 actually. Okay, next when we come, we will discuss other things. Let us break for lunch. Thank you very much.